on that one. Good morning, church.
Good morning.
It is great to have you here today. A couple things by way of announcement. I would encourage you to sign in the registration pads that are located, hopefully, near the inside of the row in which you're seated. And it's a great tool to help me learn names, remember names, and whatnot. And so we're glad that you're here today. Next Sunday is our first Sunday meal, and we're going to do our Christmas luncheon that day. Oh, you're right, it's 2 weeks.
We'll be here both Sundays.
Okay.
I had to look back at my bulletin to realize this week, for the first time in a long time, I sent Robin and Romero all of the hymns, all of the scriptures, and all of the sermon titles for the month of December.
Oh, wow.
And I have been thrown off by my efforts. I was all ready for December to start. But I will have to wait a week before it gets here. So I apologize. Well, in 2 weeks, we'll be having our Christmas luncheon, and someone has come up with a crazy idea, and I won't name names, but Robin has decided that it will be Ugly Sweater Sunday. Now, I don't know what the weather's going to be like, so you may or may not, you may want to just bring your ugly sweater and throw it on. I don't know if they're going to do a contest or what, but I might even try to buy myself an ugly sweater. I'm not sure I really own one. So anyway, it's not mandatory. It's just an optional thing to help make the mood festive that day. So
in this hot weather, just substitute your ugly t-shirts.
Yeah, right. It's Florida style Christmas. So,
ugly t-shirts
for you
if y'all have plenty of those.
For Christmas
themes. So, wear
one of those. All right. I've had a counterproposal for an ugly t-shirt. So, y'all figure it out. I'll wear an ugly Christmas tie. So, anyway, that's in 2 weeks, and I will. Chick-fil-A is due here this Tuesday. This time they're due from 11 to 2, so they won't be here quite as late, but hopefully they'll be here earlier than they made it last time. And so, with that, our first hymn is Come Ye Thankful People Come, number 694.
And I'm thankful for all the people that have come this morning. Let's all stand.
affirmation today. We're going to do something different. I don't know that I've ever done this one, but we're going to do 888, an affirmation based on 888. I'll give you all a moment to find it. This is an affirmation based on 1 Corinthians 15, 1 through 6, and Colossians 1, 15 through 20. And so we're just going to go with it today. And if it goes really badly, I won't do it again. This is the good news which we have received, in which we stand, and by which we are saved.
Christ died for our sins, was buried, was raised on the third day, and appeared first to the women, then to Peter and the 12, and then to many faithful witnesses. We believe Jesus is the Christ, the anointed one of God, the firstborn of all creation, the firstborn from the dead, in whom all things hold together, in whom the fullness of God was pleased to dwell by the power of the Spirit. Christ is the head of the body, the church, and by the blood of the cross reconciles all things to God. Amen.
Thank you, Lord, for those times when we can see your hand at work. And Lord, thank you for all those times when we cannot see or do not see. Lord, for the grace that goes before us, we give you thanks. Open our eyes to more and more opportunities to see you at work, that we might be able to give you thanks and praise. But Lord, may we never cease giving thanks. Dear God, forgive us that we have narrowed down giving thanks to a day, to a meal. Lord, open our horizons. Help us to give you thanks every day of the year and all throughout the day. Lord, there are times of challenge. There are times when our loved ones are ill. Lord, we question, where are you? Lord, I thank you that you are with us through all of the ups and downs, through all of the difficulties, through all of our movement, wherever we are, Lord, you are there with us. And I rejoice today and give you thanks for all of your blessings through Jesus Christ, who taught us all to pray together, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen.
I dreamed I went to heaven, and you were there with me. Amen.
At this time, I invite the ushers to come forward that we might all give of God's tithes and our offerings. Forget after my sermon, please remind me the other note. If I do it now, I won't make it through.
All right.
The other story is, tell God your plans and watch him laugh.
Yes, yes.
I don't know if everyone was able to hear that. Tell God your plans and watch him laugh. That's not one of my favorites, but anyway, our scripture's a little bit on the long side today. It's from chapter 4 of Acts, verses 32 all the way through 5:11. All the believers were in one heart and mind. No one claimed that any of his possessions was his own, but they shared everything they had. With great power, the apostles continued to testify to the resurrection of the Lord Jesus, and much grace was upon them all. There were no needy persons among them. For from time to time, those who owned lands or houses sold them, brought the money from the sales, and put it at the apostles' feet, and it was distributed to anyone as he had need. Joseph, a Levite from Cyprus, whom the apostles called Barnabas, which means son of encouragement, sold the field he owned and brought the money and put it at the apostles' feet. Now a man named Ananias, together with his wife Sapphira, also sold a piece of property. With his wife's full knowledge, he kept back part of the money for himself, but brought the rest and put it at the apostles' feet. Then Peter said, Ananias, how is it that Satan has filled your heart, has so filled your heart, that you have lied to the Holy Spirit and have kept for yourself some of the money you received from the land? Didn't it belong to you before it was sold? And after it was sold, wasn't the money at your disposal? What made you think of doing such a thing? You have not lied to men, but to God. When Ananias heard this, he fell down and died. And great fear seized all who had heard what had happened. Then the young men came forward, wrapped up his body, and carried him out and buried him. About 3 hours later, his wife came in. Not knowing what had happened, Peter asked her, tell me, is this the price you and Ananias got for the land? Yes, she said, that is the price. Peter said to her, how could you agree to test the Spirit of the Lord? Look, the feet of the men who buried your husband are at the door, and they will carry you out also. At that moment she fell down at his feet and died. Then the young men came in, finding her dead, carried her out, and buried her beside her husband. Great fear seized the whole church and all who heard about these events. May God add a blessing to the reading and hearing of God's holy word. This is the first time in all my years of ministry that I have ever tried to preach on this text. It is not one of my favorites. It distresses me when I read it, because I don't fully understand what all was at work that day. But the church was in a very fragile period. There were people who were just overcome with the fullness of God's blessings, and they began to live a very communal lifestyle. Not communist, because communist is from top down, where people tell you you've got to give up everything. This was people filled with God's blessings, in awe of all that God had done in their lives. times, and they were excited, and so they were giving freely of what they had. Barnabas, who we know from his ministry with Paul and later with Mark, Barnabas sold a piece of land and came and brought the proceeds to the apostles and laid it at their feet for them to distribute anywhere that people had need. And so, immediately after that, as the story goes, I feel it's redundant to keep mentioning this, but there were no chapters in the very beginning. There wasn't a break here at the end of chapter 4, the beginning of chapter 5, where 4 ends with Barnabas bringing his gift and 5 begins with Ananias bringing his gift. It all flowed together. It was a letter written to the church, to Theophilus to be specific. And this letter was just an open letter that read from beginning to end. And so, in ours, we read to the end of 4, Barnabas' gift, and then 5 begins the other. I called my sermon Truth or Consequences because both Ananias and Sapphira had an opportunity to tell the truth about the gift that they brought. No one ordered them to give it all to God. Apparently they had seen the praise heaped upon Barnabas when he brought his gift, and they thought, oh, we'll bring ours, but let's keep a little back for ourselves so that we can go to the movies or do something for ourselves that we don't have to ask for money from the apostles to do what we want to do. But they brought the gift as if it were all of the money. They lied. And Peter says that they lied not to the apostles, but to the Holy Spirit. I thank God that we are not all struck dead for lying. Because I fear there would not be any of us left. I can't speak for everyone, but your pastor would have been long since taken down. The lies I struggle with the most are the direct question lies. Did you take care of that? Yeah, I took care of that. I'll run and take care of it in just a minute, but you didn't hear my thoughts on that. It's a struggle to understand. God took the lives of the husband and wife that day, and all of us, there have been times and situations when we've lied. Sometimes we lie to ourselves. Sometimes we lie to God. Sometimes we lie to others, which is always a little bit lying to God. But I suspect if we can honestly assess ourselves, all of us have lied. And yet, we're still breathing. That's a good thing. Part of my understanding of what happened that day was that in the plan of God, God has had a plan from the beginning. But God has had to modify his plan over and over and over again because he gave us free will. We have muddled, we, the collective us of creation, have muddled God's plan from the beginning. Adam and Eve had a good gig going, and they blew it because God gave them free will, and they opted to disobey God. Later, just hitting some highlights, God had a plan to establish Abraham and his descendants, and Abraham and Sarah were patient and muddled up God's plan. But God still wanted to have Israel to be a beacon to the nations, that everyone would see the way in which the people of Israel worshiped and honored God, and God blessed them, and people would all flock to an understanding of God through Israel. But Israel wasn't obedient to the plan of God. They, instead of Israel being a beacon to the nations, Israel wanted to be like the other nations, their neighbors. They wanted a king. They wanted to worship idols like the others did. And Israel went through a lot of difficult years and ups and downs through the judges and through the kings, and they never fulfilled God's plan to be a beacon to the nations. But God always had back his whole card. His son to live among us, to give himself for us, to die for us upon the cross, that we might be forgiven. And then God established a church. The 120 grew to thousands, and among those in Jerusalem gave everything to God. And they all had enough because income kept coming in from new people being one to Christ and wanting to surrender what they had to the good of all. And it's in that context that Ananias and Sapphira come. A poison to that selflessness that defined the early church, that could be a beacon to everyone. Look at what these people are doing. They're giving up everything. Everybody has enough. Wow. Look at what God is doing. They come and claim that's all of it. Now, Ananias never has an opportunity to recant. He comes, gives his gift, and is told by Peter, that's not everything. Why did you tempt God? Drops dead. Sapphira had an opportunity to say, you know, Peter, I'm sorry, it wasn't everything we were given. Here, let me give you the rest. We were wrong. But instead she says, no, that's all of it. You got it. And she too is struck dead. And fear and amazement came on all who heard about it. What do you think happened to the next folk that decided they wanted to follow Barnabas' example? I'm sure they didn't follow the example of Ananias and Sapphira. But that period in the early church comes to an end because of persecution. Persecution by a man named Saul, who was so zealous for his faith that he decided he would put an end to this movement. And even as he put down his fist to try to stop the movement, all he did was scatter the church. It was like slapping a puddle with your fist, and the ripples began to go out from Jerusalem to Judea to Samaria to the ends of the earth. People ran for their lives. And they took with them the hope of Christ. I don't believe it was God's will for Ananias and Sapphira to try to hold something back. But it's human nature to want to hold on to something tangible rather than just turn everything over to God. How do we How will we live? How will we survive if we just trust God with everything? And that's what holds us back in some ways, that lack of faith that God will be there with us as we trust Him. It's scary to put your trust in God. I heard a story this morning that mentioned my sermon from some weeks back, and I'll tell the truth, I do not remember saying this, but according to the story I heard this morning, I told everyone that we should put our trust in God and just let go and surrender. And one of our folk was in the airport, and in a huge line, and there was no way that they were going to be able to catch their flight because the queue was just way too long to get through security. And the individual in question thought back to my sermon and said, "Lord, it's in your hands. There's nothing I can do. Just, I surrender." And moments later, a man came up and said, "Come with me and we'll move over. We're starting a new line." And she was like, "Wow. But she was still so far back that she thought, well, I'm still not going to catch my flight. But thank you, God, for getting me, for just helping me to surrender and let go of my anxiety. And directly, another man came up and said, come with me. We're starting a new line. She made her connection, and she said, thank you. Well, I still don't know when I said that or how I said it. But I've often discovered over the years that somewhere between what I say and what we hear, God is at work. And God often takes those thoughts and runs them through the blender of our brains to where we are able to hear what we need to hear. And I'm so thankful. Ananias and Sapphira could have trusted God. Or could have said, here's 80% of what we got. We want to hold on to 20% or 10% or whatever. You know, we need a little security. Because we're not really sure that God is going to see us through this process. That's perfectly okay. We don't have to everybody give everything. That was just the movement of what was going on, and they saw it and thought, oh, well, let's get in on the praise, but not worry about about actually giving it all. You know, we'll just keep back some. That was their choice. That was not something God did to teach the church a lesson. The lesson was received by those who saw what happened and thought, we better not mess around. It was that faith that transformed the world. Can you imagine that from 12 to 30 to 120 to 5,000 and 10,000, the church blossomed and grew in a very short time to huge numbers, and then the puddle was slapped. And the thought was, the church will be destroyed. Saul thought, if I arrest these people, we'll stop this movement. But that is not what happened. The movement went out, and the movement is still going out. It's rippling through the ages in ways that we will never see. Ramiro sang thank you this morning. Thank you for giving to the Lord. I think it's the full name of the song. It's one of those songs that penetrates my heart every time I hear it. Because I wonder, who has heard the word from me down through the years, who's heard the word from someone else, who's heard the word from someone else? And to think that one day there may be a line of people lined up to say thank you. Thank you for giving to the Lord. But it's not just to clergy that thanks comes, it's to those who gave offerings, to those who went on mission trips, to those who gave to missionaries, to those who have talked to a neighbor or a friend or just shared their story about what God is doing in your lives. And the ripples go out and out and out and out. Thank you for all that you have done in God's service. Help us to see with a clearer vision this week your hand at work. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen.
All right, we're going to sing hymn number 131. We gather together.
The Keller family is moving back to Ohio.
Aww. It's cold up there.
We've heard.
It took a long time to be in the move, didn't it?
It was 36 degrees this morning in the afternoon. Okay, so it's going to be another. It was probably 5 or 10 in the Columbus area. So guys, if you want to stay, we've got an extra room at the house. We'd have to bunk together, but we can work it out. If y'all get too cold up there, come on back, and you'll be welcome anytime. But I just can't tell y'all how much we're going to miss you, and we love you. People in this congregation have followed y'all since y'all were born. So from bassinets being carried into the church to junior high. It's just incredible. Anyway, I just wanted to say thank you and God bless you, and we'll miss you.
Thank you. And come back.
Now, I guess I should do the benediction. And if y'all want to come to the door, you can, or if you just want to stay put and have people come up and say, hey, or if you want to run away, it's okay. Now may the love of God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, bless, preserve, and keep us all, now and forevermore. Amen.
Amen. Amen.